What's up, guys, and welcome back to Brazil Game Cup 2015. I've finally become that guy, the last person you're waiting for before the game can start. But that's because my game crashed. I have an excuse. It's going to be game two between Pain Gaming and T-Show. Pain currently with one game lead after a real squeaker. Super close, but hey, it's the win that matters, and Pain have it on my Chloris. This time I'm going to be joined by Heflamoke. I'm beat. You can do all the work this time. And you're muted. That's what happens.
No, I'm not muted. I am muted, but it's every time I think I have the time to cast, the second I put my microphone in place and say something, like there's a light somewhere going on and people come and want something from me. I hate it. So, yeah, excuse me. Let's go.
I can take care of most of it then if you got to do stuff. Winter Wyvern. No? Dire
team. Okay. Yeah, no, just go ahead. I'll join in a second.
Jeez, look at the support I have, guys. Please give me your energy, because Heflamoke sure as hell isn't. It's game two, and T-Show are going to switch gears. Antimage is going to be banned out, Doom's still in the pool, and, well, it is a good hero versus Ember Spirit Bane. Maybe looking to grab that one this time, but taking a look at the bans now, lots of melee heroes in the ban. That's really the only similarity that these guys have, aside from, I guess, lots of regeneration sometimes. T-Show going to grab the Ember Spirit rather early, and we've seen from these teams, they aren't really too hesitant about grabbing heroes that are pretty easily hard countered. Like last time we had an Antimage second picked, and it was pretty reasonably countered by the Doom, if the Doom wasn't getting absorbed by the Lincoln Sphere. But T-Show grabbing the Ember Spirit, it's not going to be a punishment hero for Pain Gaming. It's in fact not even going to be a hero that's great up against Ember Spirit. It's going to be a hero for the Pain Gaming side, looking not even, kind of looking blindly at T-Show's draft. Broodmother and Dazzle is a sick combination. You get the Spiderling, Pseudos around, you blast a Heal Bomb on them, and Ember Spirit, he has a lot of physical resistance, but a lot of magical resistance, but he's not really able to withstand that. The Ember Spirit, most of the time should be able to counter the Broodmother, since Battle Fury is part of the build, just being able to search for the Broodmother, find her with a long-range chain, you can get the kill pretty easily from there on out, but it's going to be the combo that Pain Gaming are looking to try to abuse. And then ideally for them, they'll be able to grab a couple of more silencers or stunners, whatever, in their third and fourth pick. But T-Show definitely have a pretty safe draft opening things out. You got some magic resistance for the Ember Spirit. You got some physical resistance from the Winter Wyvern. It's going to be Legion Commander and Spectre to be banned out. That's pretty interesting. I mean, you could see the Spectre being banned out. Most of the time these games, it's Ember Spirit towards the mid lane. But LC, I don't think we've actually seen a single one yet. None comes to mind. If there were any Legion Commanders, they would have been really bad, because I just wouldn't have remembered it. But either way, are you here?
Yes, I am sort of here. Like for reals this time.
I don't know if I can believe you anymore. You've toyed too much with my heart.
But you get a doo-doo-doo. Sand King. Mm-hmm.
Sand King versus a Broodmother. It's used to be one of those counter picks when Broodmother was really frequently picked up. If you couldn't get the Axe, you'd get Tidehunter or Sand King. And with the ability to Sandstorm, you'd just be perfectly safe from the Broodmother, or go for Caustic, Burrow Strike, and actively kill the Broodmother. Yeah, this is a pretty reasonable pick here for T-Show. They probably could have picked it fifth, honestly, but hey, you gotta get your Broodmother counters up when you still can. And now Pain, they really do need their CC effects. They need a lot of them.
Yeah. To be honest, I'm a bit worried about the Broodmother, because I see Ka-Ching happening here. This is Sand King with Sandstorm plus Ultimate. This is Splinter Blast. This is the Sleight of Fist by the Ember Spirit. So far, Broodmother is facing three AoE heroes that all can, sooner or later in the game, take out all the little spiderlings if vision and everything is up. So that's kind of scary that you chip too much gold towards T-Show.
It is very easy to make that mistake of being able to feed over that many spiderlings. What we've seen from Tavo in the past was that he was a little more hesitant to just clump up his spiderlings and wander them around, going instead for the, I'm just going to spread these spiders out and get vision so that my main hero can stay alive. And that is the correct playstyle up against these heroes from T-Show, but it's not only the AoE coming out from T-Show, it's the fact that they have heroes that have a lot of mobility. Sand King is going to get a Blink Dagger, that's a given. Ember Spirit has mobility with his Ember Spirit jumps. And if they can get on top of a Broodmother with vision, like just dust or a gem maybe down the line, they can kill her off very, very quickly. Like Blink Burrow Strike, Ember Spirit uses his Remnants to jump in, and the Broodmother's just screwed from there on out. Maybe Dazzle's going to be behind her sometimes, but definitely it's not going to be the case all the time. What do Pain want to do with their third and fourth picks, however? Because this is the offlane selection for the Broodmother. Most of the time, it's going to be just that offlane. It's a Windranger for them.
Windranger. Okay. I mean, that's a cool Windranger, obviously. And we... I don't know how they're going to play this. Like, the Broodmother is one of those heroes we have seen... I don't know in BGC, but, like, generally in the current meta, we've seen her pretty much in every lane. Even some teams played her mid. I know that sounds ridiculous, but sometimes it even works. So, right now, I just assume we get the Broodmother alone somewhere, Windrunner in the mid, and then Dazzle plus another core, potentially, with another support going for a tri lane.
Not going to be Gyrocopter. Was banned out. Windranger is the pick for Pain Gaming, expecting the Ember Spirit matchup. Definitely not too late for T-Show to switch gears, grab a Shadow Fiend, grab a Queen of Pain, and get a little bit of a better matchup there for their mid lane. But I like this for Pain. Did have a pretty decent showing of Windranger Shackles in the last game. Wasn't able to get a ton of farm, but hey, I mean, got there in the end, so doesn't matter, one game. T-Show, Sand King most likely going to go towards the off lane, or at least in a solo lane, expecting the Broodmother matchup. They're going to try to either go dual lanes or, you know, try to get an offensive tri lane together. It's going to be a Skywrath Mage here.
That's a lot of roaming potential as well in this game, if you really think about it. This is a Winter Vivon slow, this is a Skywrath Mage slow, this is a stun by the Sand King. In combination with the Ember Spirit, you even have another CC, the Searing Chain. So wherever they roam, maybe a dual smoke, they can actually kill something very early on. Pretty much, we talk about level 1 kills here.
Yeah, there's a lot of aggressive power here from T-Show. Granted, Skywrath Mage, great versus the Windranger and Dazzle just for that point-click silence. Not as much so versus this Broodmother, who is just going to have a field day with this Skywrath Mage. But T-Show have a good mix of offensive and defensive power here with all of their heroes. What they are lacking, though, is really that final punch and the sustained damage output in the late game. Ember Spirit is a hero that sometimes is going to fall behind and then is just not going to do anything. So they need someone to scale with the damage. As Pain are just going to grab their Tusk. It's going to be a supporting Tusk, and we all know how ridiculous Snowball into Heal Bomb from Dazzle can be, especially on a Skywrath Mage who has like zero base armor.
Yeah, I definitely like it, because I mean, I just had a long list of CC that is on T-Show's side, and for Pain Gaming it was, well, kind of empty, that list, because it was really just the Windrunner with the Shackle, and then what, two slows, Broodmother on a modifier, and Dazzle on a spell, and that's it. Now we finally have the Snowball as well as some block and action coming in with the Ice Shards, not to mention, of course, the Walrus Punch, more or less, but yeah, finally they get some CC, and with that they also have something to roam that could potentially work out, like the Dazzle. For example, brought into a creep wave with the Tusk together and a healing bomb, that would be a nice combination if you get that off.
And they could even roam down to the Broodmother lane. Like, usually Broodmother as a hero wants to be alone, just wants to handle that lane by herself. But if you snowball in, grab the Broodmother, grab the Dazzle, heal bomb immediately after, I don't know who's going to be in that lane for T-Show, but they're going to be hurting. It's going to be a lot of damage. It is, however, worth noting that Pain Gaming are almost only in the physical damage department. So T-Show's Winter Wyvern is going to be a pretty big pickup right now. Any mech that they can get, maybe on the Shadow Fiend last pick, is going to be pretty relevant as well. But expect Pain to have a really aggressive roam time with this Tusk and Dazzle. Shadow Fiend, the last pick for T-Show, most likely is going to be going towards that mid lane. Usually between Shadow Fiend and Windranger, it's going to be, for the most part, a wash.
Yep. I also like the Tusk, by the way, because against the Sand King, it's always good to have some sort of AoE stun with you, that if he helps himself and just goes into Sandstorm, and you don't happen to have like a Dust or Sentries with you, then at least you have something on the way to stun him. How do they lane this, though? Like, is this the Shadow Fiend in the mid? You're gonna get, I don't know, some sort of dual lane, or I'm not really sure how T-Show really want to lane this.
I think Shadow Fiend in the mid lane is probably the safest at this point. You really don't want to have Ember versus that Windranger. The matchup is, you know, probably like 60-40, 70-30-ish towards Windranger, whereas otherwise it'll be more 50-50. For Pain Gaming, they're going to go all in into the physical damage department. Winter Wyvern's embrace is going to be huge at this point if she's able to get that out. But at the same time, you're talking about snowballing in with a Phantom Assassin and Dazzle, heal bomb, boom, dead, anyone, just instantly dead.
But still, look at the magical damage. That's the problem I'm facing at the moment when I look at the Phantom Assassin. There are races waiting for him, arcane bolts, there's the Burrow Strike, the chains, plus the guard, and Winter Vivon on top of it. So all five of them have quite some nice burst damage for Phantom Assassin, and we all know what happens to Phantom Assassin, especially till minute 15, 20, maybe even 30 if the farm is bad. She needs HP and a BKB ASAP here.
seconds remaining. Yeah, the offensive power is there for the PA, but she just has to be very careful not to get too overconfident, overstep her bounds. If there's a blink dagger faster than the PA can grab a BKB or at least, you know, any sort of reasonable health item, then it's going to be T-Show with a pretty large opening where they will have just more offensive power than the Phantom Assassin has defense power. It is one of my favorite heroes, though, Phantom Assassin. I just love watching the hero. It's just very entertaining to me. So I want to see this work for Pain, but I'm not really sure if this is the correct environment for it. The supporting cast is definitely there, but let's see who's going to be playing what. Tabo's going to be on his Broodmother. Haven't seen him play a Radiant side Broodmother yet. We've got Gambling on the Tusk with some weird-ass hair. ADR is once again on the Windranger. We've got HFN on the Phantom Assassin. That leaves Cat on the Dazzle.
Yep, and on the other side, the Sand King at the moment, lonely in the Secret Shop area. That's King RD on, well, I guess in the mid lane will be Sis on the Shadow Fiend, but he's in a sort of intermediate position right now. The tri lane top that is Lil on the Winter Wyvern. We have Baga on the Skyraf Mage. Well, a pretty amazing support player, I have to say. Q praised him when he played the Disruptor. It was a pretty amazing game. 23 minutes, Aghanim Scepter and everything. And Terence is on the Ember Spirit. Let's see. I think we're going to see some action top for the rune. Maybe.
Shadow Fiend, level 1, pretty darn bad. In fact, all T-Show's heroes kind of mediocre, and here they come in a snowball. Sis, you gotta run, man. They don't have any follow-up except for a small slow from the Phantom Assassin. Shackle gonna fail, as ADR took a long time to actually fire that one out. Maybe there was an angle there to actually connect it. But either way, Shadow Fiend is only working with shared tangos at this point, and because he did not grab that bounty rune, there's gonna be a slower bottle and or no salve here. So already this is gonna be a really great start for ADR.
Absolutely, like just the EHP taken out is absolutely worth it. They also have a snowball again, which means the Shadow Fiend can't even go close because he's, yeah, it's just too dangerous for him at the moment in the lane, and he has so long for his second tango, and even that won't bring him anything. So for now, it's really just about getting some XP in that lane, but bye-bye, no souls, no nothing. To be honest, I even thought they could follow up on the whole thing, but yeah, they didn't dare to do it.
Well, let's take a look at how these lanes are actually going to shake down. Dazzle taking a lot of damage, got into a little bit of a squabble with the Sand King. Is going to lead the lane towards HFN, and King RD should be more than okay in this lane. Even if, well, we'll move it to a mid lane, never mind. Sis going to get jumped by a snowball again. This time, they don't even need the Shackle to land, they just beat him down the old-fashioned way. Shadow Fiend already behind, now decisively so, as it's going to be first blood drawn by Pain. But bottom lane, the Sand King is going to be actually going for a Caustic Finale, because he can, up against the melee Phantom Assassin, but this Shadow Fiend is going to need a little bit of help. Isn't even level 2 yet, so Soul's not going to be coming his way. And this is the aggressive power of just having a Tusk. He may or may not be joined by this Dazzle, but pretty much no matter where Tusk goes, there's a lot of kill power in all of these Pain lanes.
Absolutely. And, well, they kind of adapted to the situation that happened right after the rune, because Lil already started to stack the jungle. They know the Shadow Fiend needs that farm immediately, as soon as possible. But yeah, that he's stuck around and gets killed for the first blood, that's of course a bad, bad start. By the way, also Ice on the Sand King, who's just moving for the bottom rune right now. This is interesting build.
Well, he's gonna land a 2-man Burrow Strike. Unfortunately for him, it's an illusion rune, so that's not gonna help. But level 1 Tusk, level 1 Dazzle, you know, not exactly at their prime, let's say, but still did a hell of a lot of free damage onto the Sand King, and he is probably just gonna have to base right now. Unless he wants to ferry out a salve, he's probably going to be forced to go for a bottle here eventually, but unable to get a lot of comfortable farm given the kill power. Tusk now has boots and ice shards. Level 2 on the Tusk is such a huge leap away from level 1 as far as power level is concerned. If he's going to stick on this bottom lane, Sand King's going to be in trouble. Otherwise, again, no matter where he goes, those heroes are going to be in trouble. Now take a quick look at top lane. Tavo's kind of just forced to chill in the trees right now. Sentry coverage is there, or was there for the Dire, was eliminated by Tavo. There is still dust on the T-Show side, and Tavo should be at the very least able to get experience in this lane.
And look what the Sand King is doing. He's not going back to his offlane at the moment. He's heading towards the jungle, but he has no Sandstorm. So I'm putting kind of a question mark, because I still think he could get some experience versus the Phantom Assassin. The support's at the moment just busy stacking, and the only one who actually has vision is the Tusk. So if he had Sandstorm, he would be kind of safe in the lane.
Well, ADR is right now very, very weak, so this is, in theory, the right time to go for a gank. He has boots, level 2 Burrow Strike, but it's going to be up towards the top lane where he's going to go. I think there was an attempted D-ward there from Lil, but his sentry got eaten immediately by Tavo, so that didn't happen. But now Tavo, they need the dust. There it is, plus the sentry. They have the burrow strike. It's going to connect, and Tavo's in a lot of trouble right now. Ember Spirit's going to close in with the guard, with the chains as well. Tavo's going to pop. Winter Wyvern is going to draw that kill, but it costed them four heroes in rotation. It's an expensive one, and maybe they're even going to lose Sis because Gambling's looking to make his rotation of his own. Shards available will wall off Sis. ADR's going to land a shack, but completely botched the power shot. That wouldn't have been lethal anyway, so it doesn't really matter too much. Now Gambling is on the run from King RD. There's a burst strike available, and there it is. He's going to grab the bounty rune as well. Poor King RD not rolling well with these runes, but Gambling has nowhere to run right now. He's even going to get body blocked as Sis is going to try to grab this last hit. No, it's going to be King RD to grab it after one last right click. But still, for Pain, that backfired in a pretty big way.
Crazy amount of commitment here. I mean, four heroes top, four heroes in the mid. I mean, yes, they get two kills, but I'm not really sure if it's really worth it, because you will eventually fall behind in experience if you do that all the time. Not to mention that you gave up your bottom lane. This is four minutes and a half into the game, and this tower is about to fall. So you give up a lot for this.
HFN doesn't even have a Rumored Aquila right now, yet this tower is still taking an absolute beating. Not going to be destroyed by the Phantom Assassin, so that kind of sucks for her. Sand King is going to grab an Invis Rune. His leaving the lane, I think we kind of both thought that he wouldn't be able to get that much by leaving, but you know, he got two kills on his hands, not too bad. Over towards mid lane, Sis though, going to get hit with a Shackle once again. ADR has a power shot. Blind, close your eyes and let it rip, ADR. I believe in you. Oh, boo, he's not even going to fire it. That kind of sucks, but Sis, either way, is without his bottle right now. He's going to get it delivered, and well, he'll be fine to stick in this lane for a little while longer. 1-2 on T-Show, though, they do get those kills. That tower, for the most part, for Pain, going to balance all of that out.
Yep, and also Phantom Assassin, we soon have the magical level 6, which means the RNG is then soon enabled. From there on, we always, it's the big question mark. If he jumps on you, or she jumps on you, does she crit or does she not? That's the big RNG for Pain Gaming here, and I'm looking forward to it.
Well, I tell you something, Bog is not looking forward to it. Zero base armor is the Skywrath Mage. We're not looking at like one-shot territory for a good portion in this game, but it hurts like hell. And really, like, the more important thing than just being able to blink on someone and crit them is being able to chuck the Stifling Dagger at them and crit that one, because that is like no command from the Phantom Assassin. It's dirt cheap for her mana pool. And it hurts like hell. Like, that's pure damage nuke right there. So, yeah, good luck surviving that one. For Pain, though, they are getting now Broodmother a lot of extra time up on top. The Brood versus Ember Spirit matchup, 1v1 like this, is actually really good for the Broodmother here, because Terrence isn't able to actually kill off any of these Spiderlings, since his AoE damage is all over time. You could, I guess, chain some down, but that's not going to be worth it. So Terrence is going to be facing up against a increasingly larger and larger Spiderling army, and Broodmother now has access to the jungle as well, where King RD is in the area, but even though he's a Sand King, he's not completely safe against this Brood.
Yep. How's Brood doing anyway? I mean, yes, the Sol Ring is there. She's going for a Midas, it seems, so going for the real greedy build. She's trying to capture at least like two of these camps while the Ember Spirit is taking the lane. She kind of fears that the support's rotating, and if she knew the support's actually hovering somewhere around the mid, I guess she would be a bit more aggressive against the Ember Spirit, but for right now, I guess she's just fine. She needs her level 6 soon, and then also the Spider push should start as soon as the Ember Spirit might join other fights somewhere.
Well, she's going to start Spider pushing right now. It might cost her, because King RD and Baga are going to smoke up. Thinking about the Broodmother, thinking about ADR, it's going to be them settling on the mid lane Windranger. Burst Strike now level 3 with Tranquils. There's a lot of movement speed here for the Sand King, and it looks like ADR is going to go aggressive onto Sis. Bad timing for that. He's going to with the Burrow Strike. One raise, two raise. Easy kill. Two TPs coming in for Pain. One will be canceled. And it looks like it's going to be a very easy snipe on ADR. It looks like, you know, in theory, if it was just Sis versus ADR there, I think the Windranger might have been able to get that kill, or at least a lot of free damage, but just by sheer happenstance, not the right time to do it. So T-Show with another rotation. Notch another kill for themselves. Yet despite these kills, Pain are just last hitting better. They still have a gold lead.
Absolutely. I mean, this was the perfect bait. Talking about bait, do they have vision here? The Broodmother is pretty much right next to them. They're rotating in, but she's like, nah, you're not gonna find me. Now she's in the trees. There's just no way. Random dust, but nah, she was out of range. They might as well just settle for the small spiderlings.
It's like 70 bottom. Gold. You get a little bit of profit, I suppose, with that dust. Not what you want to be doing, but Beggars can't really afford to be choosers. HFN has had just like an absolute free time. There's been no one in this bottom lane for the entirety of the game. He's gonna go Agitret. He's gonna go Ringer Aquila turned on. And now the pressure is going to mount. The Winter Wyvern coming to this lane is not the right hero to stop this push. And oh, Sis is actually... No, I thought he was going to put the courier at risk. Here comes King RD with the Tranquil still active. Shards will lock him off a little bit and slow him down. ADR are going to be just fine. But this is a free farm Phantom Assassin. And this is one of the more scary heroes that is in this game of Dota that can do a lot with free farm. I don't know what build she's going to go for, but... Honestly, it doesn't matter that much. It's going to be a damage item and a BKB. Yeah, I don't know.
It's very strange to me because, like, if you look at the draft and everything and you just erase the last 9 minutes that happened, you would say, okay, Tisha is going to focus on the PA, so PA doesn't get any farm. But it's quite the opposite at the moment. They are happy that the Ember Spirit is doing okay-ish in the lane and the Broodmother is very passive, not pushing too much. But giving so much space to the PA, this is just not good. It's absolutely not good.
Gets the first hit crit on King RD. Probably like the first stifling dagger she's thrown at a hero since she picked up that level 6. And of course it's a crit. HFN has clearly been practicing. And he said, Tisho, they are like applying, I guess, the most pressure towards ADR, but it's not even that much. They are roaming around occasionally, but the Sand King's not really getting enough to justify the fact that he only has 1 point Sandstorm and needs to be farming towards that Blink Dagger. The Skywrath Mage has been fairly stagnant, as has the Winter Wyvern. Seems like Tisho are just okay playing this super, super slow game. And yeah, the late games are, I suppose, aren't too far apart from either side, but Pain, they have a very explosive mid game. Like, Phantom Assassin is a carry that gets active once she grabs her BKB, and if she wants to go for that first, Pain Gaming might just get in underneath the Tisho's Ember Spirit if he's, you know, gonna continue farming up towards top and not getting any of these kills. And oh, Baga, he's gonna dust up an army of Spiderlings, but the Spiderlings are just gonna see him and jump towards him. Ember Spirit's gonna jump in, save the Skywrath Mage. Grab about 60, 70 gold from it, but still Baga has got to try to TP away. Here come the Spiderlings. They actually might have a surround on Terrence, who has no counterplay against this, but man, Broodmother committing absolutely nothing to get a hell of a lot and actually sees the Ember Spirit leaving. Now the push is going to continue. He can jump right back, but Tavo is going to be absolutely free to do whatever he wants in this top lane.
He can also start creep skipping if he really wants to, but he of course has to be careful. The Shadow Fiend is actually rotating in. He's going for a Mac first, it looks like, but can they actually do something against this? I mean, they don't have vision, so what is he actually doing here without a support?
Not really sure. The Spiderling army isn't that large, so Tavo isn't really a significant threat right now. Sis is just kind of being there. It's giving the Winter Wyvern close to his level 6. I guess that's what you're trying to do with the Shadow Fiend, but I don't even know if Mechanism is the right item in this game. If they had a Sand King who was more farmed, I think they can apply pressure, but it seems like Tisho, that's just not in their plan right now. Like, Blink Dagger and Sand King is still 1,000 gold away, and it's not easy to come by with level 1 Sandstorm.
No, absolutely not. I mean, the Sand King, he's not going into the jungle because the jungle is more or less occupied by the Shadow Fiend. There, by the way, smoked up with the Skywrath Mage. They're going towards south. Maybe in the mid there's a bait happening on the Winter Wyvern. To be honest, I think the Winter Wyvern could have been in the mid baited it out, but they're not gonna do it. Instead, they're gonna head here towards the Phantom Assassin. This might be actually good.
She's gonna get silenced and she's gonna run into a Sand King lift as if that was even necessary. Sand King's gonna steal the kill. Yeah, that's just the wrong place at the wrong time for the Phantom Assassin. Has 2,000 gold, so she lost quite a bit from that death. But for Tisho, they get the kill on the Phantom Assassin as we were expecting up towards top lane. Terrence, though, gonna get jumped by the Broodmother. Looks like that's not gonna result into anything. Pain are more than okay playing this as a really slow game, but they're also not going to be outdone. They're going to smoke up with the Tusk and the Windranger, go up towards the north lane. Should a Shackle land, that is level 3. They do not have the Walrus Punch, however. I feel like they might need that if they're going to kill off the Ember Spirit.
His Remnant is at the moment very, very close in an area where you can actually see it when he goes there, so they can follow up. And at the moment he's hiding because he knows that's a bad idea. The Broodmother just laying a web. Check in where he is, the Frozen Sigil, and one Spiderling going for it. Now he TP's out, but his TP means the end of this tier 1 tower. At the same time, Windrunner going back into the mid because they want to prevent that Phantom Assassin from dying, and actually it works.
As he throws some shards, she's going to jump right back in. Of course gets a first hit crit because that's how it always is. They're onto Lil now. There is a Embrace, but the Power Shot's going to counterbalance that. Dagger is going to start counterbalancing it as well, but Lil should be fine. Ember Spirit going a little bit too aggressive, and on the Phantom Assassin, you can't really blame him, but unable to grab that kill. It is a tower-for-tower trade, as both safe lanes are destroyed by each other, but the Broodmother's still making her home up towards top, and this is a pretty sizable spiderling army, Tisho have got to send someone to deal with it. Sand King finally does have his blink dagger, however, now he is a significant threat.
Yep. And the Broodmother, like, I really don't like this Broodmother because I think she could be a lot more aggressive. With all this action in the mid, I thought, okay, we're gonna see her already, like, you know, fighting some pieces of the tier 2 tower, but at the moment she's so farm focused, she's really 100% farm focused. And I was actually wrong, she didn't go for Midas even though she had the chance to. She just went for PTs and the Vladimirs, and that's it. What do you think she's gonna go next? Do we see... What's the current Broodmother build anyway in nowadays meta?
You know what? I'm not sure what the global Broodmother build is, but this is the build that we have seen almost exclusively from Tavo. And then I think he goes for just more pushing items, like or an SNY rather, just going for the fights. He's going to catch Terrence though, ADR randomly from the trees. Shackle might not last long enough and he's going to jump away. Ember Spirit will be fine. But yeah, we've seen Tavo go for SNY, but that was like kind of a rough game. Most of the time, he's just been able to get whatever he wants, including a Radiance. So he may decide to go for that route as well. I would say probably a toss-up between those two items.
I think it might be even too late for this. And if he wanted to go for this build, then why not Midas? He really had the chance to finish it. And if you're anyway just sticking around in the jungle, you might as well just go for that Midas, go full YOLO, full greed. At the moment, he doesn't push. So why not just going for that? I will not understand, but in the mid, oh, there's a go on the Shadow Fiend.
And the Walrus Punch, ADR doesn't have an angle right now, and here comes the Epicenter, and of course the Flare. That's a super dead Windranger. Camling gonna try to TP out, that's not gonna work. Tisho crushed the mid lane with a surprise Blink Dagger from the Sand King. It always seems like Pain are just choosing the wrong points to go aggressive. It's always when the Sand King is right around the corner. It's going to cost them two heroes. Tavo now going to start to kick into gear with the push, but the heroes are coming in, and he's with a lot of spiderlings right now. King RD is going to land the blind burst strike onto Tavo. They see him right now. He's going to pop the ultimate now and just try to go for King RD, but he can't really afford to do that with only one point of incapacitating bite. He just doesn't have enough sticking power. Spiderlings are now going to be chucked towards the Sand King, but he's going to blink right over them. Tavo is now going to lose a whole lot of his spiderlings as well as his own life. One raise is going to get his about 100 gold. Secondary raise. That's not going to happen. It's going to be a little to clean house. But 2-7 and Tisho are locking down Pain's heroes pretty effectively. But still, we could see they're not really making anything happen after that. They're getting the kills, but their towers are still falling. And Tisho are not getting anything close to resembling a push going on their own. Terrence is really struggling to keep up with farm in this Phantom Assassin. He's 2,000 gold behind.
Yep, this is going to be one of those games where Tisho will not have a base anymore, but they're at least leading in the kills. Unfortunately, it's called Defense of the Ancients and not who gets the most kills. That's what it always comes down to. Pain, yep, they're moving forward. Even the Broodmother, I think she even had a chance to survive this, but she went forward and was still in the range for the tier 2 tower, for the vision. Other than that, I think she had the chance to actually become invisible again. Dust expired. Dust expired, so that was nothing. Actually, she's coming back to the lane, and the first thing that happens there, she's found. And I think that's an easy kill. Or it should be. Now she's popping the ultimate and now feeding off the neutrals, but in the end, it's still enough.
Yeah, if you get caught with the Mystic Flare and a Sand King there with the Burrow Strike, I don't really care who you are. Unless you have a BKB, you're probably just going to fall. Broodmother is being reasonably dealt with here by Tisho. Their tier 2 tower is not that healthy up on the top lane, and now over towards mid, ADR and HFN gonna go straight for that. Jump forward and back for a little, gets a double crit, immediately prompting the curse out. Power shot through is gonna get the kill, and Shadow Fiend's going to arrive a little bit too late, but they have a nice Burrow Strike onto ADR. Gambling gonna slip out of there. ADR getting body blocked, but does land a two-man shackle, seeing the Sand King and Terrence both. He needs a little bit of help here, however, has the heal, has the grave. ADR should not die just yet. Burrow Strike might kill him off, and well, Dazzler's gonna make a clean retreat. I think that might just be the correct decision. Ultimately, though, it is the Windranger to be traded for that Winter Wyvern, and that's pretty much the end of it. But for Tisho, they have a whole bunch of heroes in the mid lane. They might be in a good enough position to go for a tier 2 push here.
That's very interesting, to be honest. I mean, the PA going really, really deep. I think she was lucky that on that Winter's Curse, there was no one else around, because with a triple race, for example, like she still dies to that. She only has 900 HP, and a Battle Fury doesn't really help you there on the way with your HP. But yeah, the Winter Wyvern, that was his desperate move, getting rid of that Winter's Curse in order to survive. But yeah, the power shot was on the edge, but it still got him, and it's a one-on-one trade. If you take the Broodmother from top into account, it's a 2-for-1 trade, so Pain again, just making, yeah, not the right play here when it comes to amount of kills. But they already did some nice siege damage before that.
Their Phantom Assassin is working with the Battle Fury right now, so her farm is not going to explode necessarily as much as that of the Anti-Mage, simply because she lacks the spammable mobility from Blink. Doesn't have the right kind of Blink, let's say, but still is able to accelerate her farm a lot. And Ember Spirit should be looking for a Battle Fury of his own, especially going up against the Broodmother. He's really nowhere close to it, so expect this Phantom Assassin to probably go for a BKB next, and then in those fights, I mean, yeah, they can still use the Winter's Curse to stop her, but actually killing her off afterwards is going to be very, very difficult as long as she has that magic immunity turned on. So Pain, though they are 6 kills behind right now, they did kind of drop that team fight over in the mid lane. They're still not in a terrible position at this stage in the game. The Broodmother's keeping a couple heroes up on the top lane for Tisho. If they don't have those heroes there, they're simply just going to lose their tier 2 tower. And that is going to free up the rest of the team to do whatever they want. And what they want to do right now is let HFN have at it at this ancient stack. Unfortunately, got two dragons, so there's a lot of armor here. But HFN is taking like no damage from these guys because of the level 4 blur, plus the armor from the Helm of Iron Will. She's going to clear that one out and maybe grab a Helm of the Dominator now. Yes.
She's still critting for over 800 on the dragon with like 8 armor, so it's all good. Well, there's the Scarab Mage actually going for the Dazzle. There's no silence on him, so he could, if the ultimate comes out, just Shadow Craven. That's pretty much it. So just a bit full from back. 3-9 here, 19 minutes. And if you look at the crafts, this game is still totally open. I mean, yes, we see all the kills and everything, but just one big fight. Roshan is soon a topic we have to talk about. This could turn either way. When it comes to siege damage, we already emphasized it like 3 times. Pain is making larger steps forward than Tisho, definitely.
Pain have a much better draft at killing Roshan, I think, but Tisho have a really good draft at crashing that Roshan pit. Just the ability for Winter Wyvern to fly over, curse someone. Sanking, of course, Blink Epicenter is insane in the Roshan pit. Pain do have enough power on the Phantom Assassin to maybe solo it. Do they have Medallion anywhere? No, not quite yet.
The Broodmother could do it right now. Like, Broodmother and then maybe someone else coming in, they could really sneak a Roshan, but the problem is Tisho is on the Dire side, so that's always very awkward. You're not really going to go for it. Baga and King RD, they're top, and they're just waiting on the sidelines, but the problem is the mini Spiderlings. Spiderlings, they scouted all out. The Shadow Fiend gets a tier 1 tower. By the way, for the fact that he was the first blood and everything and had a horrible start, he's leading now the net worth chart alongside with the PA, who had free farm pretty much all game except for the 2 deaths.
And the lane opponent, the Windranger, is really starting to fall behind. ADR having a much rougher time than that SF. His, not only behind the Shadow Fiend, but behind by quite a bit. That's 3k difference. She's going to close in on her Aghanim Scepter, and that is a pretty substantial item, so her health pool will be around that of the Shadow Fiend. Damage output, at least through right clicks, will be kind of similar as well. So this is Windranger with definitely the ability to recover, given just a couple more minutes of farm. But I mean, look at the Shadow Fiend's farm, and yeah, he's pretty damn farmed at that. The Ember Spirit's still struggling. Like, since I last checked up on him, 3 minutes ago, he's gotten a Perseverance, which isn't bad, but he needs that those additional items. He needs to be some sort of threatening hero. The Shadow Fiend, as powerful as he is, cannot do it all when he's going up against the likes of Phantom Assassin and, well, the mischance from the Broodmother's Incapacitating Bite, which is going to be picked up a little bit more down the line. Shadow Fiend will struggle to do it all by himself without someone else doing significant damage.
Yep, definitely. And, well, still, Broodmother, she doesn't know where the enemy is, so she's holding back, but she's doing quite a nice job with the mini Spiderlings. Always one little Spiderling in each and every direction, scouting out. Unless there's smoke, Yeah, she is not really in jeopardy, but talk about a bait or anything. Now I think she should show, because there is Tuscan Windrunner waiting for that gank on the Broodmother, but it's not gonna happen. Actually, they are around Roshan. This is not a Roshan attempt or anything. I think they were just trying to bait again with the Shadow Fiend. I mean, he's master bait of this game so far. Every time Pain engaged on him, the Bad Awakening came right after.
Shadow Fiend has presence of the Dark Lord, even has a little bit of lifesteal coming on the courier. They were spotted moving into this pit, though, by the Observer Ward. I think it actually did see them, and let's actually take a quick look. It does see King Ardu. He's actually going to teleport out, TP out from the Winter Wyvern as well. Terrence Assist will get a double damage rune, jeez. I don't know if it really matters that much, but now they're going to be able to clear out Roshan and get back up to this top lane to maybe get a fight going. The tower's already
I think they want
to start things off. It's going to drop. Winter Wyvern with one Splinter Blast grabs 100 gold. double life now for the Shadow Fiend, and it looks like double damage will eventually time out, but it's the classic tier 2 for the Roshan trade, and both sides, historically, are pretty okay with that.
To be honest, I think, like, as I said, I don't know if Pain saw them moving into Roshan and consciously decided, no, guys, we're not going to go for this fight. If they did so, then I guess the tier 2 for Roshan was absolutely right. If they didn't see, then I'm not really sure. It was kind of a risky move because they didn't really know where they stuck her on. However, now Tisho might be on the move because they have the Aegis, they could fight. The Shadow Fiend is at the moment tanky enough to be really the center of each and every fight. He has two lives. He gets at least one Requiem out, I hope. If not that, two Death Animations.
Caught with the Flare, silenced up as well, but the Aghanim Scepter health pool keeping him very much so alive, and Phantom Assassin wants in. She's gonna get a lot of cleaves also onto Sis. They trap Bogga with the shards and pick him off immediately. BKB not even used just yet by HFM, but here comes the Snowball, jump forward onto Sis. He's gonna end up using his Aegis soon. No, he's gonna once again taunt with Requiem, and now he's completely trapped. Like a rat in a cage, he will eventually fall to something. Someone do something to this guy and kill him off. Take out his Aegis. He's going to get embraced. There's another power shot soon, so this is definitely going to fall here. But here comes the Epicenter. HFN has no BKB up. He's going to survive, though. Blink out to Cat. Maybe even get a little bit of extra healing here. Lil going to hit with a Shackle, but warded away by the Ember Spirit. Had no chains. In the meantime, it's the Broodmother to make the serious plays up towards top lane. And Tisho, they're going to try to retreat right now. Looks like they will all get away. For HFN, he did survive. They do take out the Aegis of the Tisho side, however, and they don't lose anything. They also take out the tier 3 tower. I didn't know Broodmother was going that fast. Wow, that's nothing but wins there for Pain.
I have no idea what just happened to Tisho, but they had a they just had the Roshan. They should have been the aggressive ones, but after the Skywrath Mage tried
King RD.
Oh my god. King RD, you're in wrong area, right there. Wrong neighborhood for you. No mana, no nothing for him. And look, even the Broodmother going full aggressive here on that Shadow Fiend. He doesn't have any Aegis anymore, but now Broodmother has to be careful. There's the third raise, but look at the PA just going for Winter's Curse, helping the Shadow Fiend out for just a second, but there's not really much they can do. Now he's jumping on. Oh, that poor dragon, he's going down. I think the Shadow Fiend is going to follow up right after, and now they're really in trouble. PA is just going for it. Look at this, crit.
And a Shackle to boot. Shadow Fiend's not going anywhere. He just fought back. He's going to try to Requiem, but he will fail. The Death Requiem not even doing that much because he just doesn't have many souls. He just fought back. He just threw away so much gold by doing that. And this is the power of Phantom Assassin once you grab BKB. There's nothing that Tisho can do about it. Whoever's teleporting in here probably would be best canceling it. Terrence is just going to bounce away real quickly, but HFN can give chase if he wants to. Melee Rax still alive. Someone finish this up. Here comes King RD. He's going to miss his Bro Strike. Cat heroically going to go for Raxes and gets before he dies. ADR going to get swiped down as well. But Melee Rax is taken by Pain. The Broodmother can pretty easily clean up the range Raxes from here on out. And HFN walks away so many kills richer. Those last couple of fights going absolutely disastrously for Tisho. This is a level 16 Shadow Fiend just bought back. He cannot afford to just throw that gold away and then die again. 9-12 in Pain, though, they're still behind in kills, much like last game. They are in full control of this game. The Courier has, well, just a mixed bag of things right now, but looks like it's going to be a Yasha for HFN. And yeah, Mantis style should be probably the next pick. Just get rid of the chains, get rid of the silence. This Phantom Assassin is already going off, and she's not going to stop anytime soon.
Can we give the Dazzle a Medal of Honor post-mortem? Yes. Because he was definitely the MVP. He was just running in, and at that point of the fight, it was a Dazzle with only Prime Boots and like two Gloves of Strength or something like that. So really just the original right-click damage, base damage coming from him. And the two hits he did on the melee Rex was actually exactly the two hits needed. So that's why Pain, regardless of dying, still came out here winning even more after they had two great fights already.
For sure. Highest honors to the Dazzle. Had his eyes on the prize and made damn well sure that his team got away with that objective. If not, Tisho would actually be in a decent spot right now. I mean, not a terrible spot, let's say. They do have to worry about Broodmother split pushing, and that was really what started that whole cataclysmic chain of events. But now that the range Raxes are exposed with no melee Rax there, just the creep wave is usually going to be enough to kill off the range Rax, but with the Broodmother there as well, it's definitely going to fall sooner rather than later. And now the map is a little bit more open for Pain. They're going to focus their heroes over towards the bottom lane, maybe even go for this tier 2 mid. It's definitely possible for Tisho to win these fights. They need souls in the Shadow Fiend, they need a Requiem to land, they need a Curse and an Epicenter, and use the burst power of the Skywrath Mage. But if they fail to lock down this Phantom Assassin with the Curse and then actually kill her off or drop her really low thereafter, I don't really know if Tisho can actually make it happen. Not to mention the fact that ADR has been landing shackle upon shackle upon shackle.
Yeah. And now the question is, I mean, I'm still kind of baffled by the single fact that Tisho came out of Roshan. I thought, oh my god, Pain, now you're really in a painful position, if I make that pun, you know. And I don't know, Pain turned it around, got rid of the Aegis, got rid of pretty much everything, and rewarded themselves with this rack. So I'm not really sure where this game is heading, because every time Tisho has seemingly an advantage, they don't play it out. That was game one already the problem, and game two, I think we have pretty much like a mirror match when it comes to the destiny of, I don't know, late game, mid game, whatever you want to call it. It's the same thing.
Well, luckily for Tisho, this time they have an Ember Spirit who does have a Battle Fury, they have a Shadow Fiend, so yeah, their late game is definitely scalable, but again, it really hinges upon their ability to lock down this Phantom Assassin, and therefore they need MKBs desperately to try to cut through this blur. 50% evasion is no joke, and there's a Solar Crest in the Broodmother, so that can get even worse, plus Insatiable, or the Bite from the Broodmother, we're going to make Mischance happen. I don't know what the total tally of Mischance is there from Tisho, but it's a lot. Like, if they're trying to hit the Phantom Assassin while the Incapacitating Bite is on them, while the Solar Crest is on the PA, good luck doing that. However, getting a smoke up is going to work. She's going to blink right over the trees, and looks like King RD was not actually spotted there by HFN because it is nighttime. That smoke was not going to do anything, it seems. They're all going to back off. 9-12 at this stage, and Pain, what's the next goal for them? Is it time to wait for Roshan and just play very safe with the Broodmother? It seems like that's probably the safest thing to do, but King RD has a gem right now. He sees Tabo, blink Burrow Strike, easy flare, and that's an easy kill on the Brood.
Yep, with some nice bonus gold from Spiderlings. However, look in the mid, there's already the Focus Fire on the tower. They have to use the cliff right here. Pain, I love how they use the map. They know exactly, okay, if they're top, we go mid, do some damage, get the cliff baited out whatsoever. I think for Pain, okay, now that the Broodmother, of course, now that the Broodmother is dead, of course, everything changes a bit, but when she was still alive, I think they can really just hover around in the area, wait till Tisho makes a mistake, and they will reward themselves with the Rex, simply for the fact that there are no more buybacks on Tisho. So whenever Pain gets a good fight now, this might be additional Rex, if not even the end of the game. So Tisho, they have to be careful, they have to wait for their cooldowns, they have to get the gold up for the buybacks. That's the only way they can recover from another bad fight.
For the record right now, HFN, with only like one item that you would call a damage item in that Battle Fury, is critting for 14, almost 1500 on zero armor targets. So really, it's you just gotta factor in the armor percentage into account, and minus that, it's that's all HFN's pure crit damage. Not to mention Cleave, not to mention the attack speed from the Phantom Strike, and of course the daggers. She's hitting like an absolute freaking truck right now, and also has another item coming out. It's a Basher. Again, not really a huge damaging item, but hey, the utility of Bash might just be enough if she gets a little bit lucky, gets a first hit Bash, gets a crit after. Yeah, things get really ugly if the Phantom Assassin's gonna play the RNG game, and it seems like she is gonna be a pretty good player at that game. She's been practicing, as I said before. This is Phantom Assassin getting almost, well, I mean, not really super close to six slotted, but she's like super effective in this game, even without being remotely close to six slots.
I mean, right now, and that's the funny part, I think right now she could one-shot the Skywrath Mage with one armor, and the other two supports are more or less a two-shot if one of them is a crit and another hit. So this is pretty much the truth when it comes to the PA, and the only thing they have against her is still the Winter's Curse. And to be honest, the Winter's Curse, wrong or not being used, was one of the reasons they had this bad fight right after Roshan. So a lot of these fights, in which direction it will go, comes down to the Winter Wyvern. I'm really looking forward, if he finds the right Winter's Curse, the burst down before the BKB is on the PA, I think Tisho might have a good shot on a fight. But if PA gets the BKB off and they just hold her a bit in place, then this is not gonna work out.
What's 4.5 times 300? Because that's how much HFN is gonna crit for right now. Let's grab the Alpha Wolf, and it's a you know, pretty much free for him. That's like free damage for the Phantom Assassin. As long as the wolf is able to stay alive, that is a disgusting, disgusting amount of gold. That's 12, 24. Yeah, that's a lot.
Wow.
It's like 1700. I don't
know.
Love
your exact math. That's 1, 2, 3, a lot. Yeah, that's perfect science, Mike.
It's almost 2000. I was close. I didn't hear any suggestions from you. Jeez.
You know, that's, I suck at math. That's why I don't even attempt to calculate anything. Not when I'm put on the spot. Not on the microphone.
They get 600, 600, that's 1200 plus another half, and Olsis is gonna run right into it. Here comes the crit. Burrow Strike is there. HFN has no BKB available. Epicenter is gonna be used. The curse is there, but the BKB is already up from HFN. Plus, the Dazzle has arrived, plus ADR. He's gonna jump right towards Sis. The Embrace is gonna keep the Shadow Fiend alive for a little while longer. In the meantime, Terrence has gotta just book it out of there. Focus Fire is on the King RD. Here comes the Phantom Assassin. Two shots gonna kill off the SK, and now she's gonna kill off a Centaur because she can. Sis is trapped out, and he's gonna get shackled once again by ADR. Almost 100% success rate. They're gonna jump towards Terrence. Gets a bash, gets a crit. The Ember Spirit's gonna jump out of there. He will survive for a little while longer, but HFN just has running around with no answer. Now here comes Tavo. Gets slow onto Sis. The missed chance is there as well, and he's gonna get, well, embraced for a little bit, but he's completely surrounded, and he's completely boned right now. He's gonna try to go for HFN, just not doing nearly enough damage. That's gonna be a 2-0, and now Roshan is a super easy grab here for Pain. It's a decisive win, and you could give a lot of credit to HFN. Give as much as you want. ADR Shackles are winning Pain these fights.
Yep. But again, Tisho, the use of the ultimate is, I think, the missing link in their fight, in their chain of disable, chain of damage, and focusing down a target. Because the Winter's Curse, again, way too late on a target that was already BKB'd and didn't even go for the Shadow Fiend at this point. It could have waited till she comes a bit closer, or could have waited till the BKB fires off. Anything like that. Also, the doo-doo-doo ultimate, the epicenter, it pretty much did nothing. It absolutely did nothing. And these two ultimates, they have to come out. The rest was kind of okay. Even when the Shadow Fiend was surrounded, he still had a good fighting chance against them. But yeah, he had no team left. Everybody abandoned him already at this point. So Tisho, I don't think they're out of this game by any means, but these ultimates, they have to come.
They needed the ultimates to layer on the Phantom Assassin before she got the BKB up. Once that was up, Epicenter does nothing. And now their base is going to be sieged on the mid lane. Top lane, Rangerak, somehow still alive. No one's been able to finish that one off. But with everyone on Tisho back up alive, they have another Epicenter soon. The Aegis has gone towards ADR, and HFN is just looking for some poor sucker to jump on. Scarf Mage has minus 22 armor because it got woven up. Blink Forward, though, gonna catch Cat. That's a super dead Dazzle, and there's no response at all from his teammates. Curse onto HFN this time. Is there enough follow-up? Requiem is gonna be there, but it's gonna be mostly blocked by the BKB. And Assassin forced it back on out of there. Pain are on full retreat right now. King RD has forced that Blink and Burrow Strike, but he can't find a target. They only lose the Dazzle and an 8-second BKB charge? Yes, from the Phantom Assassin. It's
this
a defense from Tisho, and at this point, I think they should be really happy with that.
Yep, this is absolutely good. I mean, taking the Dazzle out of the equation means that Pain Gaming, there's no way they're gonna go High Crown without the Dazzle, because, like, if something goes wrong, you need the Shallow Cry from your Dazzle, not to mention the heal, and the Weave obviously helps a lot, especially if you have a lineup like a Phantom Assassin that is based on armor. And, yeah, also getting more and more BKB charges off the Phantom Assassin, this is really good news, because at the moment, this BKB of the Phantom Assassin is like the golden timer of each and every fight. So Tisho, not losing too much on the tier 3 tower, on top of what already was done before. It's good news, but of course, still Pain Gaming. They get away with a BKB charge and a Dazzle kill and still do a lot of siege damage while also top is pushing, and it's... Well, they cannot play this much longer. They have to get a good fight with results.
Ember Spirit, he's not in, like, one-shot range just yet, but if he gets blinked upon by this PA, now with an Abyssal, Terrence may just fall. He does have a lot of cold, so he has buyback several times over, but still, if he falls, oh, ADR almost landing that Shackle, then that's just going to be a free pickoff for Pain and not an inconsequential one either. Going to jump instead towards Lil. Big crit, 1557. There was a Winter Wyvern there. HFN going to pop the BKB to dodge damage from this player. Now going to go for Baga. Two shots to kill off the Skywrath Mage. And who's next? Who wants to pick a fight with this Phantom Assassin? Step right up, because HFN is more than happy to take you one at a time. ADR is going to look for a Shackle. We'll miss it because of the Sleight of Fist. Now he's in a lot of trouble. MKB going to cut right through that Windrun. A Shadow Fiend does draw that kill, but HFN's ready to pounce. Has no BKB. ADR does. He's going to get that one off, and he's going to just back on out of there. He's going to be just fine right now. The tower has fallen in exchange for the Aegis and a BKB charge. That's a long one. 10 seconds on the Windranger. Tisho have no Skywrath Mage. ADR going to slowly chip the melee racks. I think go for ranged here if you're Pain. I mean, it's too late, obviously. You already casted the ultimate, but it's still a threat. This HFN, Phantom Assassin, can jump in and, well, live up to her name, let's say, versus pretty much anyone, especially since BKB is going to be up again in just 15 seconds.
You say slowly, but like every time that Windrunner is actually touching that Medirex, it's losing too fast, too much. That's the biggest problem at the moment. But Tisho, as long as it's really just the Medirex, it's healing up, so the longer pain is not actually finishing it. It's good news. What I dislike at the moment is that the Broodmother is not doing anything top. I mean, you could send Spiderlings over there. Actually, she has Spiderlings there, but that's the life of it.
Blink forward, Abyssal, Bro Strike is there. HFN gonna take a full on Mystic Flare, but now the BKB comes up. She already got the BKB off, however. Ziss is gonna try to pop his Requiem, does get it off, but gets immediately brought down afterwards. It's a Broodmother for Shadow Fiend so far. Shadow Fiend is gonna force to buy back as the Bro Strike does miss. HFN blinks out from right underneath that. JK Gambling is gonna be the one who's gonna get chased down. Guardian Greaves used, but he's gonna lose the gem. And it will be Ziss now chasing forward, looking for HFN and ADR with the rest of his team behind him. They're going to guess the wrong direction, however. Both these two heroes gonna slide up to the top side. HFN has no TP scroll, but it looks like they're going to be able to slip on out of there. That's another successful defense by Tisho, as they were able to bring down the Broodmother pretty darn quickly.
Yeah, but was it really a successful defense? It was a very expensive one. The previous push, the Winter Wyvern had to buy back because he has that crucial ultimate that needs to come out. Without that ultimate, Tisho pretty much lost the fight, and now they bought back on the Shadow Fiend, which means now, regardless of a Super Clash fight or a single gank on the Shadow Fiend or even on the Winter Wyvern, if Pain gets one of these two heroes, they pretty much have such a big advantage that the fight should and has to go their way. So right now, Tisho is again in a position where they have to wait out, have to wait for gold and their 5-minute cooldown on that buyback.
And they're also kind of in a race with the Phantom Assassin Satanic. It's probably going to be her next item, and once she grabs that, I mean, she's critting for 2,000, so that's like a full heal if you crit and you forget 1 HP. So, yeah, good luck dealing with a Phantom Assassin who has that as an asset. But just the health is going to be huge for the PA. The Shadow Fiend's doing an okay amount of damage, and the Ember Spirit has grabbed an MKB as well, so they're definitely getting their physical. And they now have the ability to cut through that blur. But HFN, once he grabs a Satanic, can man fight with anyone on Tisho. And the ultimates there from Tisho afterwards are really not going to be doing that much. It's just kind of slowly bringing the Phantom Assassin down. You'd expect an Epicenter and a Flare to be bursting down this Phantom Assassin. That's just not the case. So Satanic is just a hop, skip, and a jump away from this for this PA, and that's going to be a huge asset for her. Tisho once again placed a really freaking weird Observer Ward on this bottom lane. I don't know why they keep doing this. It doesn't actually do that much.
What? Which one? Where?
On the bottom lane.
You mean the Roshan one?
No. Bottom.
Oh, did I see? I didn't even see. Yeah, it's like super on the edge of the map. But yeah, I don't know what it does. It's yeah, not much. What they actually gain from that war.
Gonna look for the Broodmother immediately. It gets shackled though. ADR is gonna prep the focus fire. Needs an embrace. It is there. But now here comes Gambling. They're gonna get the curse onto ADR. That means there's no curse ready for the Phantom Assassin. The Walrus Punch is there onto the Winter Wyvern, who should be brought down by the Broodmother. And now Ziss is just all alone. I don't really know why these two heroes were here. Shackle's guaranteed to land in such close quarters. They're going to take him down. In the meantime, Phantom Assassin and Cat just going to town on everyone else. That's an Ember Spirit down.
This is game.
Yeah, Tisho just don't have buybacks. Why do you split up like that? That is not the correct move in this situation.
I just said it pretty much, 20 seconds ago, that if they find Winter Wyvern and Shadow Fiend, then Pain Gaming will get this game. And the first thing they do is Winter Wyvern and Shadow Fiend go alone into the top lane and die there from a single Broodmother plus support TP. This was even without the Phantom Assassin. This was really just, yeah, supports and a Windrunner. Now, this is game. I don't see how they would ever defend this.
Windrunner is already going to get to the bottom lane. Mid lane is already gone. Top lane is mostly gone. And yeah, all that is needed is the GG call. Tisho get 2-0'd by Pain, who are looking like the strongest team in this tournament and therefore this region, I guess we can say. This was, I mean, a game where it looked like if you just came into this game, Pain were behind the entire time. But Phantom Assassin, man. Phantom Assassin and ADR's Shackle Shot percentage carried them through that. I'm not to take anything away from anyone else. Like, the Graves were on point from the Dazzle. The Tusk was doing his job as well. But, yeah, the scores reflect the state of this game.
Yeah, draft was fine. The early game was fine, even though they had heavy rotations and lost a lot of XP. Pain Gaming was just a bit ahead in Siege damage. Everything else was totally on the edge. Could have gone both directions. I think Tisho, what they really have to do better against Pain Gaming especially, is just these calls. Like, if you're on a timer, 5 minutes buyback and no gold, then you cannot send your Shadow Fiend, who is the crucial player, as well as your Winter Wyvern, alone into a lane, getting ganked, and that's the end of the game. I mean, they could have, in theory, even waited 5 minutes in their base. That would have been still a better play than the top lane, but they made this risky call, and they had to pay for it. Pain Gaming, no mercy whatsoever.
And that means that Pain Gaming are going to be enjoying a nice, comfy spot in the Grand Finals. They have no idea who they're going to be playing up against. It's either going to be T-Show, again, that'll be, I guess, pretty interesting. Not Today or Keystars, who are waiting in the Loser Bracket Finals. Do we get any word on whether or not that's going to be played right now? Do you know?
Yes, it will be played. The rule was, if this is going into a free game series, then we not going to have it. But since this is a 2-0, we have one more game now, the Loser Bracket Final, which is a best of one.
All right, so we got best of one. Either Not Today or Keystars are going to be booted out from that. Yes. And then the winner of that goes to T-Show. Winner of that faces up against Pain. That's going to be coming up in hopefully just a little bit of time, guys. I'm Mike Loris. If you enjoyed the cast, be sure to follow myself at Mike Loris. Be sure to follow my co-caster at Heflamoke. And follow HeflaTV on Twitter as well. Hopefully it's not going to take that long. Keystars versus Not Today should be very interesting. I'm looking forward to that one. See you in just a little bit, guys.